What's it called again?
Barba Amarilla.
It does poisonous?
Really poisonous. And the problem with working in the jungle is that you know, you don't have obviously electricity, so you don't have refrigerators, so you can't store the venom, the anti-venom. So if you get bitten, you're dead, basically. So you have to be extremely, extremely careful. You know, when I showed you that path, when I walked down that path, I had to make as much noise as possible. So if I ask next to around, I move away. The worst thing you can do is, you know, like listening to your iPod or just looking up again, not really making any noise at all. And so you have to be extremely aware of the space around. Often, I'm sort of not very observant, and often almost step on one, and one of my workers will call me back just in time. So often, I mean, this one here, they can curl up and like hide underneath the growth, you know, the leaves and so forth. And the foliage is so dense, you really can't see or can't distinguish. So, yeah, be very, very careful. The tarantula, many, you know, it surprised me in the morning, when I hit in the morning. Wasn't quite awake enough. I had that to wake me up quite rapidly. And then there's scorpions as well, quite a few around. So, you know, staying in the tent, you have to make sure that the tent is always zipped up closed. You know, like a tiny hole in the tent could cause extreme panic in the evening. So, lots of scary things as well in the lowlands. But you probably won't be accosted by any of those city cows, so don't worry too much. So, that's just to show you a bit of the geography, you know, Guatemala. On the lowlands, it's tropical, humid lowlands. The highlands are right now on the Pacific coast. Just to give you a little bit about people in Guatemala, we have, you know, about half of the people in Guatemala are the Maya Indians, indigenous people. It's more in any other of the countries, in Mexico or Belize, Honduras, for example. Ladinos is basically just the term used for people of Spanish descent, you know, mixed blood. And then we have a mix of the Roman Catholic and Protestants, and then the Maya, the ancient Maya rituals as well. One problem with the Protestant coming in is that one important sort of part of the facet of the Maya culture is this idea of the sort of closed corporate communities. The Maya people, although there's this real sort of this sort of creation of this sort of pan-Maya movement to try to bring Maya from all the different countries together to help promote the indigenous rights and so forth. But the Maya are actually very distinct. There's sort of at least 30 different languages that Maya speak. Each community is very different. And we all have, for example, their clothing that Millie mentioned, the women and the pills that they wear different pills that are basically attributed to their town. So each town is very sort of isolated, and they see their town as like the center of the world. And to leave the town and go to other towns is seen as dangerous, and they don't like people to come, you know, moving in or so forth. So it's very sort of insular. And so that's actually a problem scenario for this sort of coming together and forming this sort of strong resistance against foreign government, is to actually get indigenous peoples to see themselves as one, and not as their own sort of distinct units. So when Protestant religion was sort of spreading in the areas, and they had this very different ethic, where it's all about sort of this work ethic and leaving the town, and also not drinking, whereas a lot of the Maya rituals involved sort of the alcohol and the offerings and so forth. So it caused a lot of sort of strife between sort of the traditional Maya and the sort of more progressive Maya as well. And just some terms I want to give you, I don't really want to give you many, I mentioned the closed corporate community, which is it's been broken down a lot more today because of globalization and tourism and so forth. But the communities still do see themselves as distinct, very different from, you know, the community which is just fine to stand down the road. But you'll hear often the costumbres, I'm sure you'll hear over the next few days. And they're basically just the beliefs and the customs of the community. And each community can have very different beliefs or customs together. The traje is also very distinctive. Millie mentioned the mipil, and that's basically, you know, the blouse that the women wear. Women are much more traditional, I don't know if you've noticed it, you know, walking around town. The men tend to just wear, you know, the jeans and t-shirts, whatever. They don't really feel like they're wearing traditional garb, as it were. But the women do, and not just, you know, in the Amasada as part of the tourism sort of thing. A lot of them still wear the wheat pills continue the tradition, and also states basically where they're from, village they're from. So if you're in the know, you can see a woman wearing a particular pill, you can say exactly what village they're actually where they're from. Just a little bit about the politics and the Civil War. In the sort of 70s, there were sort of quite a few sort of people trying to sort of get together to promote sort of indigenous rights, because you know, it's half the country are indigenous peoples of Guatemala. And one of those was the Committee for Campesino Unity, sort of got together to try and the government to sort of respond to indigenous rights and so forth. And what they did was they went to Guat City and they tried to see the president at the time, President Salinas, but he wouldn't have anything to do with it. So they actually went into the Spanish embassy and they sort of protested inside the embassy to try and get sort of international attention. And in response, the government actually burned down the embassy then inside. So as you can imagine, a lot of indigenous people then got together against the government and they formed this this contract, Declaración de Chinche, and that's actually the site we're going to tomorrow. They see the site as as still relevant to them today. You know, it's not just this ancient land site, it's actually really important and part of their struggles today. And so they had a meeting there and made this contract. It's basically this all-out war against the government. And basically in response, we have a period of terror, whereby the government went into many of the villages in the highlands and basically just exterminated the population. They set fire to the villages and killed the people. And anyone that was deemed as a sympathizer, anyone who was in support of the government, whether it was killed, was really pretty atrocious. And I have some figures for you, just to give you an idea of extremity of it. At least 50,000 indigenous people were killed, leaving 116,000 orphans. And actually, between about 150 and 250,000 people were forced into permanent exile. And many of those people actually went over the border to Mexico, and many moved up to Chiapas, and that's also part of the reason why we see the Zapatista rebellion happen too, around that time, a bit later on that time as well. So it's extremely extreme. By the end of 1982, 32,800 native Guatemalans were actually living in about 28 camps as refugee camps along the Mexican border. And also at the time, the government set up a civil patrol system in the villages, whereby the people had to give a part of their sort of working day to helping the government in different sort of projects, but which included also spying on people. It's sort of a bit like in the Carthy era, whereby anyone, next door neighbour could, if you didn't like your next door neighbour or anything, you could just say anything there, affiliate with the guerrillas. Person would be arrested, tortured, and so forth. So it's a pretty horrific time. And it also caused a real sort of disruption to the indigenous people in the area as well. Also with the natural catastrophe that happened around that time. In 1976, there was a massive earthquake. And that killed numbers. It displaced many, many people in the highlands. And it actually killed 20,000 so really, that's had a real sort of disastrous effects in the highlands with the natural disaster and civil war that's been going on. Some of you have already read, I'm sure all people probably know about Rita Virgin and Chu, and we mentioned her in civil. But she's wrote about the struggles during the civil war. She's a K'iche woman, and she wrote that book on the women in Guatemala. And she received the Nobel Peace Prize, actually. Her work has been criticised by one anthropologist, David Stoll, nitpicks on things, her father wasn't this poor man, actually more wealthy than the family and so forth. And it's caused a bit of an uproar in the anthropological community because it's they feel it undermines, the genocide, yes, it went on with the people, that it undermines the what she's actually talking about, the actual horror that went on. I mean, she did like to look after that.
Crossing borders.
Yes, it's like the snow.
The her crossing borders.
Okay, yeah, crossing. I'm sort of stating that, sort of correcting certain things and so forth with that. So there was this coming together, have about 1995, of these peace accords. They actually weren't put into being, as it were, until about 1996. So basically, the government and the people declared, I guess, there was a discrimination against indigenous peoples. Need to put steps into rectifying it, having Maya taught in schools, and people being discriminated against on the vote, and this sort of thing. But really, not much has been done about that. There's still quite a few of the terms need to be implemented. And it's sort of quite hypocritical in that, I'm sure you came into Guatemala Airport, you see all these signs in Guatemala which shows either Tikal or it shows Mayan women and Hill and so forth. So whenever the Guatemalan government promotes Guatemala and tries to get people to come, they always use the indigenous Maya, either the ancient Maya or modern Maya. But the irony is that they don't have any of the rights, extremely poor, malnourished people. So they're happy to use them to bring them in, and they're actually sort of happy to help them in their lives, their rights and so forth. And then the final thing I just want to mention is the Maya movement, the Pan-Maya movement in Guatemala. It's this movement mainly based on sort of intellectuals, sort of university educated people, Guatemalans, and international, Western people as well, and trying to promote the Maya, bringing the Maya together, not just in Guatemala, but in Mexico as well, promoting their rights and education, the languages in schools and so forth. But the only issue with it is it is like Western and sort of middle class, upper class, sort of Guatemalans. They haven't really been able to touch sort of the grassroots sort of organization of the people themselves. So the actual indigenous people are sort of more concerned about just surviving from day to day. So sort of the ideal is, it's a great ideal, but in practice it's not really sort of moving forward so much. And it has a lot of international help as well, which there's some sort of indigenous Maya is sort of a little bit suspicious of as well in a sense. So that's what we have at the moment, the Pan-Maya movement. Okay, so that's what I really wanted to mention. That's just a bit of the sort of background to the rise and so forth. So just a little bit of the economics. Two-thirds of the children in poverty, 75% below the sort of poverty line. There's extreme inequality of people. You have a very small percentage of people earning all the land basically. You can see it in Tibo. You have extremely rich people coming in from what city. In there, sort of Mercedes and so forth, and you're mapping out sort of babies on the street. So it's extremely unequal distribution of wealth. Extreme corruption in the government and just limited investment opportunities. And then indigenous people sort of are very suspicious of banks and government and so forth. It's very difficult for them to sort of be able to take out loans and things like that. Even like the family that I lived with, who sort of see themselves as sort of pretty modern, more of like Latino. They don't have bank accounts, they just don't trust banks. And they very much take out loans amongst each other in the community. They need to take out money or ask a friend rather than actually going to a bank. So that's sort of limited the ways of sort of being able to invest in this and so forth. And one other thing about the economics is something that's really important to state is that many indigenous people follow sort of subsistence agriculture, just basically farming enough for themselves, for their family, to last them. And they're not sort of so much seen as sort of interested in making more money and expanding and so forth. And they have this basic system of just basically maize, beans and squash. Many also understand the importance of growing other sort of fruits and vegetables in the market to sort of make a bit more money. So broccoli is a big thing. A lot of them are producing, and Guatemala is a big export of broccoli. An interesting thing is strawberries as well. And until recently, hadn't even tried strawberries. It was just this export. They planted them and exported them and hadn't even tasted strawberries. So they are, they should, the indigenous Maya should be seen as just these sort of, often when I talk about them, there's this general understanding that they're just, for want of a better word, sort of underdeveloped or backward. upward, you know, they're not taking part of this, the globalization and so forth, but they are, you know, in their own way they're doing it, but trying to remain, keep their sort of distinct traditions as well. So they have a full of land and they plant, they need for their family, but they also partake in these sort of other enterprises as well. And one important thing is the weaving, the women in these weaving collectives, whereby they can actually, you know, they're making their own heels, and they're also making needles for the tourist market, and they learn, you know, which sort of colours work best and so forth. And we actually have a wonderful video I want to show you a little bit of. Carol Hendrickson, she's an anthropologist, and she worked with people in Antigua and outside with the women collectives. And it's really quite an amazing sort of organisation of sort of women getting together, and, you know, to sort of make enough to sort of sustain the families and so forth. But before I show, I just got one or two more on the economics. We might see this when we're actually driving to Tikal from Flores, or coming back from Flores to Tikal. The main form of sort of agriculture is basically just the Swidden agriculture, which is basically, you know, you have a plot of land, and then they basically burn the plants and so forth on the land, and it produces these sort of nutrients, and they leave it fallow for a year or so, and then that sort of it's extremely productive for sort of the next plant season. So often, I remember when I was going to Tikal, going back from Tikal, you'll see these fields that are just burning, these burning fields. I often sort of wondered what was going on, but that's what's happening with the agriculture. So I just want to share a little bit with the women. I know some of you are interested in the weaving. So they talk about the collectives and their